الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. إن شاء الله تعالى tonight we're going to speak about the third event from the event of the seerah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Sheikh said قصة الموضع الثالث قصة قراءته صلى الله عليه وسلم سورة النجم بحضرتهم يعني بحضرة المشركين. فلما بلغ أفرأيتم اللات والعزى ألقى الشيطان في تلاوته تلك الغرانيق العلا وإن شفاعتهم لترتجى فظنوا أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قالها ففرحوا بذلك وقالوا كلاما معناه هذا الذي نريد. ونحن نعرف أن الله هو النابع النافع الضار وحده لا شريك له، ولكن هؤلاء يشفعون لنا عنده. فلما بلغ السجدة سجد وسجدوا معه فشاع الخبر أنهم صافوه، وسمع بذلك من في الحبشة فرجعوا. فلما أنكر ذلك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عادوا إلى شر مما كانوا عليه. ولما قالوا له إنك قلت ذلك خاف من الله خوفا عظيما حتى أنزل الله عليه وما أرسلنا من قبلك من رسول ولا نبي إلا إذا تمنى ألقى الشيطان في أمنيته. فمن فهم هذه القصة ثم شك بعد ذلك في دين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولم يفرق بينه وبين دين المشركين فأبعده الله، خصوصا إن عرف أن قولهم تلك الغرانيق يراد بها الملائكة. The Sheikh said the third event, the story of his sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recitation of Surah Najm in their presence, that means the presence of the mushrikeen, the polytheist. And when he reached the ayah, فَرَأَيْتُمُ اللَّاتَ وَالْعُزَّى, have you then considered the Lat and the Uzza? Surah Najm. The shaitan inserted words into his recitation, into the recitation of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because the shaitan is a fitna for the people, a trial, saying those are the exalted gharaniq, means angels, and their intercession is hoped for. They thought that the Messenger of Allah had said it, so that they rejoiced at that. And this is what they want. This is what they want, because you have to understand, mushrikeen, they don't deny the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't deny that. If you ask them who created them, they surely say Allah. But the problem is that they use intermediaries. They use Lat, Wal-Uzza, Wa-Manat, you know, these idols that they worship. If you ask them, say, these idols, they're not going to harm you, they're not going to benefit you. Why are you worshiping them? They can't even talk to you. They say, well, we're using them as intermediaries because these idols, they represent righteous people, you know. So we're using them to get us closer to Allah. You understand? This is their argument. So now when the shaitan inserted this statement, then they thought that Prophet is with them. They thought that's it, he's with them. He agrees with them now. You understand? So they thought he was with them, alayhi salatu wassalam. So he said, they rejoice at that. And they said a statement, the meaning of which is, this is what we want. This is exactly what we want. We know that Allah alone is the one who brings benefit and causes harm. We know that. You see? So when he reached, and he has no associates, however, these will intercede for us with him. It means the Lat wal Uzza, right? So this is their argument. And also you find the great worshippers today, they say the same thing. They say, well, we don't worship them. This is Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani. And Sheikh Abdul Qadir he has his jah with Allah. He has like a great position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Shaykh is going to intercede for us. You know? This is what they claim. Shaykh Abdul Qadir, he was a righteous imam. Yes. Nobody denies that. He was a righteous man, righteous imam. He had karamat and the like. But it doesn't necessarily mean that we worship him. No. Likewise, Sayyid al-Badawi in Egypt, Sayyid Zainab, al-Dusuqi, Ahmed Bamba, and many, many other places where people go, there is like a special musim season where millions of people converge to these places. You'll be shocked. They sacrifice in the name of the wali. They make tawaf around the shrine like they're making tawaf around the Kaaba. You'll be shocked. Some of them, they write their request. I want a boy, girl, something like that. You know, some of them, they write letters to the Messenger of Allah. Can you believe? Read letters. It's ajeeb. It's very strange. It's like he's going to get up from his grave and read this. It's very, very ajeeb. Very ajeeb. So that is the lack of tawheed. When someone doesn't know tawheed, doesn't have knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will go this far.
At least it's called
kufr. Shirk. When you call upon other than Allah, is it shirk billah?
Shirk is
kufr. Shirk, yes, absolutely. Yeah. Yes. Whoever calls upon other than Allah, he is a mushrik. He's a kafir. It's a nullifier of Islam. When you use someone as in, ya Shaykh Abdul Qadir, subhanallah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Madad, madad ya badawi. A'udhu billah min dalik. He say, Ya Badawi, madad, madad. Help us, help us. Yeah, a'udhu billah min dalik. And one of the scholars from India, I believe, forgot his name. He was going to Hajj. He's informing about the condition of the Muslims. So these are hujjah, the people that are actually going to perform Hajj. Or they were traveling by sea. And the sea turned very rough. It was very rough. So they thought they were going to die, right? You'll be shocked. He said, many of them, they started calling upon Shaykh Abdul Qadir. La hawla wa la quwwata. Ya Shaykh Abdul Qadir. La ilaha illallah. Then it was Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where is Allah? You see? Even the mushrikeen, at the times when they are in trouble, they call upon Allah. They call upon Allah. They don't call upon Shaykh Abdul Qadir or anyone else. So this grave worshippers, they call upon al-awliya wa-salihin. And so this is what they say. However, these will intercede for us with him. Lat wal-uzza. We know that they will not harm us, nor benefit us. They, why in the world are you worshipping them? Well, they said because they are our intercessors. They are our shufa'a, intercessors. مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَعَ. We worship them only to get us closer to Allah. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ دَالِكَ. So that's what shirk is all about. So when he reached the verse, this is a fitna, this is a big fitna. He reached the verse of prostration in Surah Sajda. He prostrated to sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they prostrated. The mushrikeen also prostrated along with him. The news then spread that they had befriended him. Look at that. That they had befriended him. And those were in Ethiopia. Remember, the first migration was to Ethiopia because of the harassment and the persecution and all that. So when they heard that, Naam, al-Habasha, heard that thus returned. They returned. They said, things are going to be all right now. Right? But when the Messenger of Allah repudiated them for resorting to that which was more evil than what they were upon before, when they said to him, you said that, he was in great fear of Allah. And Allah revealed to him, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ وَلَا نَبِيٍّ إِلَّا إِذَا تَمَنَّى أَلْقَى الشَّيْطَانُ فِي أُمْنِيَتِهِ فَيَنْسَخُ اللَّهُ مَا يُلْقِي الشَّيْطَانُ ثُمَّ يُحْكِمُ اللَّهُ آيَاتِهِ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. This is exactly what happened here. And that's why this ayah was revealed. Never did we send a messenger or prophet before you. But when he did recite the revelation, or narrated or spoke, The shaitan threw some falsehood in it. Look how the shaitan threw some of the falsehood in the recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You see? So they heard that. They thought it was the messenger of Allah who said that. But the reality, the shaitan, he said that. The shaitan who said that. Tayyib. The shaitan threw some falsehood in it. But Allah abolishes that which with which the shaitan throws in. Then Allah establishes his revelation. And Allah is all-knower, all-wise. The Shaykh, he said, he who understands this story and afterwards has doubt in the religion of the Prophet ﷺ and does not differentiate between it and the religion of the polytheist, then Allah distances him from good. Particularly if he knows that he intended the angels by their statement. Al-Gharaniq al-Ula. It's Al-Gharaniq al-Ula that they seek in their intercession. Right? Those are the exalted Gharaniq, means the exalted angels. Sheikh Saleh bin Fuzan al-Fuzan, he said, the story that the Sheikh rahimahullah has mentioned from amongst the stories of the prophetic Sīrah is called the story of Al-Gharaniq. It is, as he has mentioned, the story of when he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, recited Surah Najm, while both the polytheists and the Muslims were alone with him. When he reached the statement of Allah, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ اللَّاتَ وَالْعُزَّةِ وَمَنَاتَ الثَّالِثَةَ الْأُخْرَىٰ. Have you then considered Allat and Al-Uzza and Manat, another idol of the pagan? The other third, they were the biggest of the idols of the Arabs. Subhanallah. Look, subhanallah, how the shaitan is very tricky. He's very deceptive. He does not settle for less. He does not settle for less. Because committing zina, fornication, gambling, and other than that from the major sin, is nothing compared to worshipping other than Allah. It's nothing. That's why shirk is the worst sin. The greatest sin, liyadu billah, is the, as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he asked the Prophet about the greatest sin. He said, أن تجعل لله ندا وقد خلقك. Subhanallah. That you set up a rival against Allah while Allah is the creator. Can you imagine that? Somebody associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and al-hiyadu billah, he denies all the favors of Allah upon him. The Shaykh said, hafidhahullah ta'ala, they were the biggest of the idols of the Arabs. Lat was in Taif. Lat was in Taif. And as has preceded, he was a righteous man. See, everything boils down to someone being righteous, and what they do, the shaitan tricks them. And where they make an idol. Some of them, they make monuments. You see? And that's why in Islam, images are haram. Because images, they will lead to that. They will lead to that. People start worshipping and the like. Start using saints and the like. That's what happened exactly to the people of Nuh. They became excessive when it comes to the righteous people. وقالوا لا تذرن آلهتكم ولا تذرن ودا ولا سواعا ولا يغوث ويعوق ونسرا. Subhanallah. And he said, do not abandon your idols, your deities. Do not abandon ودا وسواعا ويغوث ويعوق ونسرا. There were five righteous people amongst them. So when these five passed away, what happened? The other generation, they began to become excessive, ghulu. And then they made idols out of them. Then they began to worship them. They used them as intermediaries. And that's why Allah sent Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam to correct this. So he remained up amongst them 950 years. Subhanallah. But subhanallah, look, the shaitan is very tricky. Very tricky. Fadl.
Also, in all the previous like Oman nation, like
Allah, he mentioned in the Quran, like, وَمُتْرِفُوهَا. Is that
yes.
The wealthy people that were like...
Yeah, kind of the mutrafin.
Mutrafiya, like, you know...
Luxurious people.
Ego. Because the area was associated mostly like with the wealthy people of that tribe, you know?
Yes.
The same thing, I think, the same case with the Quraysh.
Yes.
They used to have, like, a season, I guess... Other people that came from other tribes, other like trader that came over there.
Yes.
You know.
Absolutely.
And so it's like it has something to do with their economy.
Nah. Yeah. So when this righteous man, he was a righteous man. So Lat was a righteous man. He was in Taif, who used to feed the pilgrims. So he was good. He used to feed the pilgrims, and this is something good. When he died, they performed i'tikaf in his grave. Subhanallah. They performed i'tikaf in his grave, seeking blessing from him. And the way they seek blessings from the righteous, as the people of the pre-Islamic days of ignorance would do. Likewise, they would seek intercession from him with Allah, because he was a righteous man. You see? So they use him as intermediary. A'udhu billah min dhalik. Al-Uzza was an idol of the people of Mecca, close to Arafah. It was a name for some trees, upon which was a structure from which they would seek blessings. Subhanallah. As for Manat, it was an idol between Mecca and Medina, close to Medina, close to Mount Qadid. It was an idol of Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, the two tribes. Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj. The two tribes of Al-Ansar. They used to assume ihram for Hajj at it. Out of magnification of it. Allah says, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ اللَّاتَ وَالْعُزَّةِ وَمَنَاتَ الثَّالِثَةَ الْأُخْرَى. Have you then considered Al-Lat and Al-Uzzah? And Manat, another idol of the pagan Arabs, the other third. Meaning, inform me about these idols. Do they benefit you or cause you harm? Rather, they cannot even defend themselves. This is because when the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam conquered Mecca, he destroyed them. Had they been gods, they would have averted harm from themselves and defended themselves. Allah censured and rebuked the polytheists who were attached to these idols, which neither bring benefit nor cause harm. So when he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, recited this verse, the shaitan, i.e. the voice of the shaitan, inserted some words into the recitation of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as follows. So this is what the shaitan says. Those are the exalted gharaniq. And their intercession is hoped for. This speech was from the shaitan. He inserted it of that into the recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Messenger of Allah was unaware of that. However, the polytheist heard it and rejoiced, saying, because they thought it was coming from the Messenger of Allah. It was not coming from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was from the shaitan. He mentioned our gods with good. This is what we want. We only seek from them intercession. Beside this, we know that they do not bring benefit or cause harm. However, we want their intercession. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, and the intercession is hoped for. So when he reached the end of the surah, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَاعْبُدُوا. So fall down in prostration to Allah and worship Him. He prostrated. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the Muslims prostrated alone with him, and the polytheists prostrated.
What was the verse again?
Surat Sijda.
No. I mean,
this verse? فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَاعْبُدُوا.
When the shaitan
recited. Oh, okay. I got to go back to it. I'll give you the number of the... Okay, the shaitan. It's... It's from Surah Sajda, Surah Najm, Sajda, I'm sorry, Surah Sajda, Never did we send a messenger or a prophet before you. But when he did recite the revelation or narrated or spoke, the shaitan threw some falsehood in it. But Allah abolishes that which the shaitan throws in. Surah Al-Hajj. Surah Al-Hajj, ayah 52. Then Allah establishes his revelations, and Allah is all-knower, all-wise. So it is Surah Al-Hajj, ayah 52. Yes. So he prostrated, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Muslims prostrated along with him. And the polytheists prostrated, rejoicing at these satanic words, to the point that Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, who was old and could not prostrate on the ground, took a handful of dust and prostrated upon it. The news began to spread that the Messenger of Allah had reconciled with the polytheist, and that he had affirmed their worship of Lat, Al-Uzza, and Manat, so that intercession could be sought from them. The news that the Messenger of Allah had reconciled with the polytheist, or that the polytheist had entered Islam, reached those Muslims who had migrated to the land of Ethiopia. So they returned from Ethiopia. And when they reached Mecca, they discovered that this news was incorrect, and that the polytheists were still displaying enmity towards the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and oppressing the Muslims. When they informed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he had said this word, those are the exalted angels, and the intercession is hoped for, he became extremely sad, and he was tremendously grieved. But it was not him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was just shaitan who inserted that recitation. Until Allah revealed his statement in Surah Al-Hajj. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ وَلَا نَبِيٍّ إِلَّا إِذَا تَمَنَّى أَلْقَى الشَّيْطَانُ فِي أُمْنِيَتِهِ فَيَنْسَخُ اللَّهُ مَا يُلْقِي الشَّيْطَانُ ثُمَّ يُحْكِمُ اللَّهُ آيَاتِهِ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ لِيَجْعَلَ مَا يُلْقِي الشَّيْطَانُ فِتْنَةً لِلَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ وَالْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَالْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ لَفِي شِقَاقٍ بَعِيدٍ وليعلم الذين أوتوا العلم أنه الحق من ربك فيؤمنوا به فتخبت له قلوبهم وإن الله لهادي الذين آمنوا إلى صراط مستقيم ولا يزال الذين كفروا في مرية منه حتى تأتيهم الساعة بغتة أو يأتيهم عذاب يوم عقيم. Never did we send a messenger or a prophet before you, but when he did recite the revelation or narrated or spoke, the shaitan threw some falsehood in it. But Allah abolishes which the shaitan throws in. Then Allah establishes his revelation, and Allah is all knower, all wise, that he, Allah, may make what is thrown in by the shaitan a trial for those in whose heart is a disease of hypocrites, hypocrisy and disbelief. And those and whose heart are hardened are certainly the wrongdoers, are in opposition, far off. And that those who have been given knowledge may know that it, this Quran, is the truth from your Lord. And that they may believe therein, and their heart may submit to it with humility. And verily Allah is the guide of those who believe to the straight path. And those who disbelieve will not cease to be in doubt about it, the Quran, until the hour comes suddenly upon them, or there comes to them the torment of the day after which there will be no night, i.e., the day there will be no night, i.e., the day of resurrection. Surah Al-Hajj. Allah invalidated that's which the shaitan cast into the recitation of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and abolished it, i.e. removed it, and he affirmed his verses, which he revealed in criticism of the idols and the worship of them. This is a summary of the story. This story has come by way of Ibn Abbas with a connected chain of narration. And it has also come on the authority of some of the tabi'een with mursal chains of narrations. And some of the scholars have criticized it, i.e. the authenticity of the story. From them is Al-Imam Al-Kathir. He said, it has not come except by way of mursal and discontinued routes of transmission, which has been spoken about by the scholars. However, Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar in Fath al-Bari holds a different opinion. He said, the story has come via different, distinct route of transmission, having different sources. Therefore, they support and strengthen one another. This is the meaning of the statement of Ibn Hajar, rahimahullah ta'ala. The intent of the Shaykh in citing it is that the polytheist said, we don't worship these idols, believing that they create, provide, benefit or harm. We only worship them, seeking intercession, that they should intercede for us with Allah. So Allah invalidated this and affirmed the Quran as it was proven false. The worship of the idols, he invalidated what the shaitan had cast into the recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was consoled and the grief departed, for this happened to the messengers before him. Allah said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ وَلَا نَبِيٍّ إِلَّا إِذَا تَمَنَّى. Never did we send a messenger or a prophet before you, but when he did recite the revelation, or narrated or spoke. Meaning when he recited the word, here tamanna in this verse means recitation. Like the statement of Allah, وَمِنْهُمْ أُمِّيُّونَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا أَمَانِيَّ وَإِنْهُمْ إِلَّا يَظُنُّونَ. And there are amongst them Jews, unlettered people, who know not the book, but they trust upon false desires, and they but guess. Surah Al-Baqarah. Meaning they only recite, and they don't know the meanings. Likewise, the poet said regarding Uthman, تَمَنَّى كِتَابَ اللَّهِ أَوَّلَ لَيْلِهِ وَآخِرِهِ لَاقَى حَمَامَ الْمَقَادِرِ. He recited the book of Allah at the beginning of his night, and at its hand he met the decree when he was killed, radiallahu anhu, Uthman. This was the night on which he was killed, radiallahu anhu. And the beginning, you know, he was killed while he was reciting the Quran, subhanAllah. It's Khawarij. He was killed by Al-Khawarij, Uthman, radiallahu anhu. He was praying tahajjud and reciting the Quran when the Khawarij attacked him, killing him at the end of the night, radiallahu anhu. Look, subhanAllah, these people, they killed the best of the people. A'udhu billah minhum. They killed Uthman, radiallahu anhu, and they killed Ali, radiallahu anhu, too. They killed Ali, radiallahu anhu.
And were they burning the places as well? No. Were they burning the places as well at that time?
The Khawarij. I can't remember, but they killed Uthman. They killed Uthman, radiallahu anhu, while he was performing the salat, reciting the Quran. Yeah, can you believe that? Someone would do something like that? A'udhu billah. The point of reference from the line of poetry, Tamanna kitab Allah, he recited the book of Allah. So when the intended meaning, Tamanna is recitation, so the meaning of when he did recite is, when he recited the book, the shaitan threw some falsehood in it, meaning into his recitation. He threw words which the one who heard it thought were from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, while proved false the speech of the shaitan and affirmed these verses. This is because Allah is the protector of his religion and the protector of his book. The point is that the polytheists rejoiced when they thought that the Messenger of Allah agreed with them in this speech, that they thought was the Messenger of Allah, whereas it was from the shaitan, saying that there was no harm in seeking intercession with the idols. So they rejoice at that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala proved that false, clarified that it is not permissible to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for any reason whatsoever, seeking intercession or other than it, worship is a right exclusively for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is not permissible to worship other than Allah for any reason whatsoever. وَيَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ وَيَقُولُونَ هَؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاؤُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. In Surah Yunus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and they worship besides Allah things that hurt them not, nor profit them. And they say, these are our intercessors with Allah. So inshallah, we want to have like a little discussion, inshallah, about this topic. You heard, alhamdulillah, enough. We want to have a discussion about this. Anybody would like to share with us what they have learned from this session? Brother Adam? Fadal. No, Fadal. We start from there. Yes.
And it was distorted. Well, what being recited has been distorted.
Yes, a part of it.
What people heard is different than what actually recited. And the mushrikeen consider seeking intercession with their gods.
Yes.
Permissible.
Because they thought that the Prophet ﷺ agreed with them.
Yeah.
And now he reconciled with them. And they thought that that particular recitation that was thrown into the recitation of the Prophet ﷺ was from the Prophet ﷺ, but it was not. So they thought it was from him, ﷺ, that he finally agreed with us and things like that. So they rejoiced. Because that's exactly what they want.
By the way, I need to remind you, what was the exact distortion? Was it?
It was an added recitation was thrown in the recitation. Prophet ﷺ, he was reciting from Surah Al-Najm. But the shaitan, he threw in a recitation that is not in the surah. Do you understand? It's not in the surah. So when the mushrikeen, the recitation that the shaitan threw in there is that these exalted angels, their intercession is hoped for. Because now when they heard that, it's not from the Prophet ﷺ, it's from the shaitan, they thought, that's it, he agreed with us. So they rejoice. Because that was the main problem that the Prophet ﷺ had with them. That's the first thing he had to tackle when he was sent to correct the creed of the people, the mushrikeen. Because the mushrikeen, they don't deny that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is their creator. They don't deny that. They know Allah is their creator, sustainer, provider. They know all that. But they use these idols as intercessors. You understand? So they believe that these idols, they will intercede for them with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see? So when they heard what the shaitan threw in, the recitation of the Prophet ﷺ, they rejoiced. This is exactly what we're looking for. You understand? And that's why they made sujood. That's why they made sujood at the end of when he recited فَسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَعْبُدُوا. Prostrate to Allah and worship Him. The Prophet ﷺ prostrated, the Muslim prostrated, and the non-Muslim prostrated, the mushrikeen. You see? So this is now you see the issue. The real issue is when it comes to these intermediaries. Intermediaries, someone who uses intermediaries in the ibadah, this is shirk. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He commands us to have sincerity in our worship. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. They were not commanded except to worship Allah with sincerity. And we don't join anything in worship with Allah. We don't join Lat, Al-Uzza, Wamanat, Shaykh Abdul Qadir Al-Jailani. Other than that, from Al-Awliya Al-Salihin, we don't use anyone as intermediary. So when he heard that from the shaitan, they thought that's it. The Prophet ﷺ, he reconciled with them, and that's exactly what we're looking for. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refuted them. He refuted them. So this is the topic that we have discussed today. Anybody can share with us some of the benefits?
Nine hundred and fifty years. Teaching
Tawheed. Yes. So that is also something very important for us to reflect on. Imagine a messenger is going to spend 950 years. Subhanallah. That's a long time. Teaching Tawheed. That's it. Why? Why was he concentrating on Tawheed only?
Because the people of Noah, what they did was they were inaccessible and exonerating the righteous people.
Yes, absolutely.
Based on images and, what's the word? Monasteries, not monasteries.
Monuments.
Monuments.
Yes.
And to the point that they began to ask something more than what it was supposed to be, which only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yes, absolutely.
For assistance and...
This is ghulu. We call that ghulu. When someone becomes excessive and it goes overboard, then most likely it's going to do something that is against the Kitab and Sunnah. You see? Like, for example, some of the Sufis, they become so excessive when it comes to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there is a poem, there is actually a poem that a Sufi poet, he composed and put together about the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And many of the Sufis, they chant this poem during celebrating al-Mawlid. Mawlid, which is the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is innovation in the religion. Is an innovation. Because the Prophet ﷺ himself, he did not celebrate his birthday. Nor did his four Khulafa Rashideen. Or the other generation. None of them did that. So it is an innovation that was initiated by the Shia, actually. Al-Qaramita. Al-Qaramita are the one actually, Al-Fatimiyun are the one that actually started celebration of the birthday of Prophet ﷺ. And then they started celebrating the birthday of Ali radiallahu anhu. Then they celebrated the birthday of Al-Hasan al-Husayn. Then they celebrated the birthday of Fatima radiallahu anhu. See how al-Bid'ah breeds Bid'ah. And the Sunnah breeds Sunnah. Going back to that, the poet said, Al-Busiri, and then now when someone becomes excessive, he said, Ya Sayyid al-Khalqi, ma li siwaka man aludu bihi. This is shirk billah. This is actually shirk. Ya Sayyid al-Khalqi, or master of the creation. So he's addressing who?
Allah.
No, Muhammad. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
He
said, Ya Sayyid al-Khalqi, ma li man aludu bihi siwak. He said, I don't have, Ya Sayyid al-Khalqi, O Master of the Creation, I have no one to seek shelter except you. Subhanallah. Ah, this is shirk or not? You agree or disagree? Is this shirk or not?
Because we said it on his birthday.
No, but listen at the wording. No, forget about the birthday. Listen at the wording. He said, Ya Sayyid al-Khalq. He's calling upon him. This is dua. Ya Sayyid al-Khalqi, mali man aludu bihi siwak. He said, I don't have anyone to turn to at times of trials and tribulation except you, O Muhammad. Is this shirk or not?
So
this is shirk.
Sayyid al-Khalqi is the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
No,
Wasf.
Wasf is a description. He's saying, O master of the creation. You understand? Okay, Ya Sayyid al-Khalq, listen to this. You have to understand that the Sufis, they're very excessive. They claim Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was created from light. Okay? They claim that he was created from light. Do you agree or disagree? Of course we disagree. And if he was created from light, it would necessitate that he would be an angel. Right. They say that he doesn't have shadow. This is excessive. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't have shadow. Okay. Now there is a lot of exaggeration, but listen to this. ومن علومك ومن جودك الدنيا وضرتها ومن علومك علم اللوح والقلم. نعوذ بالله من ذلك. This is too much. He said, and from your generosity, O Muhammad, that you possess this world and the next. Then what is left to Allah if Muhammad possesses this world and the next? And I wish he stopped there. He did not stop there. He went beyond that. He said, وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ عِلْمُ اللَّوْحِ وَالْقَلَمِ. And from your knowledge, ya Muhammad, that you know the knowledge of the pen. You know the knowledge of the pen? Al-Qadr. Yeah. And the knowledge of the preserved tablets. SubhanAllah. You know, al-Lawh al-Mahfud, the preserved tablet, none has access to it except Allah. No one knows what's in al-Lawh al-Mahfud, the preserved tablet, except Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
50,000 before.
Yes. Before. Allah is the one that knows what's in the preserved tablet, al-Lawh al-Mahfud. You understand? Muhammad does not know al-Ghayb, does not know the matters of the unseen. So this becomes excessive, wal-iyadu billah. Very excessive. And this is because of al-ghulu. When someone becomes excessive, they're going to say things that are beyond belief. Na'am. Fadda.
Because Allah, He showed him, this is not ghulu, but this is, I think, like, this is like, you know, authentic. Allah, He showed him, sort of, Ash-Shaykh al-Ghayb is the only
person. Yes, he showed him, like, of course. Allah showed him, yes.
And I know, like, even Allah, he showed him, like, you know, a little bit of the future, what's going to happen to Umam, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
That's why he, you know, come up, like, with all the hadith, this
yeah.
is going to happen, what's going to happen.
So that he can inform his ummah about those things, yes.
Na'am.
The signs of the hour, minor and major. This is all from Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So, for instance, when you say, O Master of Creation.
Na'am.
So, when we say, O Master of Creation, we mean Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Well, yes, exactly.
But when they're referring to that
point, you have to understand, the Sufiyah, they don't know any boundaries. The Sufiyahs, they go beyond
the
pantheon. Yeah. Oh, yeah. One of them, he said, Ana huwa wa huwa ana.
I am Allah.
And Allah is me. Riyadu billah. Yeah. It's too much. you be... They have no limit. One of them, he said, Subhani. Subhanallah. Glory be to me. Na'udhu billah. And in Ihya Ulum al-Din by Imam al-Ghazali, Abi Hamad al-Ghazali, Ihya Ulum al-Din is a well-known book. It's a Sufi book. And many masajid, they have this book. There is a story there. It's very, 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 very bad. Okay, now there was this murid. You know, murid is like a Sufi student. He's still learning, you know, murid. So the murid, they were taking him to see the Grand Sheikh. So the one who was taking him, he told them, have you seen Abul Yazid al-Bastami, the Grand Sheikh? He said, no, I have not seen him. He said, it will be better for you to see Abul Yazid al-Bastami one time than to see Allah 70 times. This is Sufism.
And
they called ijtihad. Yeah, they said, لَإِنْ تَرَى أَبَلْ يَزِيدْ الْبَسْطَامِ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ أَنْ تَرَى اللَّهَ سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةٍ. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. This is too much. You see? This is Sufism. Become excessive. Become excessive. Yeah.
And they called, like, ijtihad for bid'ah.
Yeah. Absolutely. Moderation in the sunnah, is better than be exerting yourself in bid'ah. You see? Because Sufism and this school of Sufis and the like, they were influenced by the Hindu philosophy and the other Persians and other philosophy. That's how they came about. You know?
Unfortunately, in Pakistan, a new university has been made. However, the government is sponsoring Sufism studies in there.
Yeah, subhanAllah, like this poet, Jalaluddin Rumi. You heard of him, right? Jalaluddin Rumi is very big in India, Pakistan. And this guy, he said something horrible. He said, I looked for God in the synagogue and I couldn't find him. And he said, I looked for God in the church and I couldn't find him. And I looked for God in the mosque and I couldn't find him. And then I found him in my heart. Can you believe this? This is the most horrible statement a person can say. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he cannot be inside physically in someone's heart. Cannot be. Yes, the love of Allah in your heart, the fear of Allah in your heart, but not Allah himself. You understand? Not Allah himself. Because this does not befit his majesty to be inside his creation. You know? Allah is above his seventh heaven. Allah is above his creation. And Allah is distinct from his creation. He's not mixed with his creation. Because in Hinduism, they believe that he is mixed with the creation. Al-Iyadu Billah. Alhamdulillah, al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they believe Allah is distinct. He's not mixed with his creation. Can you believe somebody say that? And this was like actually, it was in a documentary about the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the people that actually the media pick, they pick a lot of ignorant people. So they pick this person, and then he brought this statement of Jalaluddin Rumi. When he said, I looked for God in the synagogue and I couldn't find him. I looked for God in the church, I couldn't find him. I looked for God in the mosque, I couldn't find him. And finally, I found him in my heart. This is Sufism. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be inside someone's heart. It does not befit his majesty. Allah is distinct from his creation. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa. The most gracious rose over the throne in a way that befits his majesty. But Allah is not mixed with his creation. But the problem is, now you find Islam is distorted by this sect. Whether they are Shia or they are Sufis, and other than them, they distort the image of Islam. They distort the image of Islam. Khawarij and other than them. And that's why it's very important to sit in the circles of knowledge and learning the affairs of Aqidah. Look, we mentioned just now, Brother Adam, he brought up the da'wah of Nuh, alayhi salatu wa salam, 950 years of da'wah work. SubhanAllah, 950 years. Some of the mufassirin, they said only 7 followers. That's it. Only 7 followers. And you find so many Muslims, they're involved with this grave worshipping. They go into the shrine, Al-Jishti, Al-Qadiri, Al-Sahwardi, Data Darbar, Al-Sayyid Al-Badawi, and other than that, in Tanta, in Egypt, other areas. And you'll be shocked. The same people, they come to the masjid and perform the salat. They fast the month of Ramadan, they do all these things, but they don't understand that they are violating all this ibadah. They're violating tawheed by committing shirk and calling upon other than Allah. So that's why it's good to sit and learn. Anyone wants to share a benefit with us from those who are with us in the class? No,
the Mushrikeen would have been fine with the call of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so long as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't open and criticize them. So
right.
When Shaitan added the...
Inserted
the falsehood in the statements in Surah Al-Najm.
Yes.
They rejoiced and honored Allah after Muhammad prostrated. They themselves prostrated as well.
Exactly. So because the mushrikeen, they would have been fine and okay with the Prophet ﷺ as long as he did not criticize their idols. But when he started criticizing their worship, that this is shirk, then they had a problem with him. You see? So now when he recited the ayah from Surah An-Najm, and the shaitan inserted words, because they thought those that recitation was coming from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was not. What is the recitation? Anybody can remember? What was it that the shaitan inserted? Anybody can remember?
May their intercession be hoped for.
Well, what intercession?
Of the idols.
Those exalted angels. Exalted angels. That their hope, their intercession is hoped for. Okay, so now the shaitan, he inserted this into the recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The mushrikeen, when they heard it, they said, that's it. He's with us now. He reconciled with us. You know? That's exactly what they're looking for. Because if he said that Lat wal Uzza wa Manat, they are intercessors. That's exactly what they want. So now those Sahaba who fled from the persecution and they went to Ethiopia, when they heard that, when they heard, because the news was going far and wide that the Prophet ﷺ reconciled with the mushrikeen, what did they do? They came back. They came back. And when they came back, they found out a different story. They found out that it got even worse. Because Allah revealed the Quran and refuted what they were saying. Refuted that. That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was not in accordance with their shirk. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was upon tawheed. They were upon shirk. You see? So the shaitan, he created the biggest fitna for them. So they heard the recitation of the Prophet ﷺ, and the shaitan, he inserted certain words about al-gharaniq. Al-gharaniq are the angels, exalted angels, that their intercession is hoped for. So they said, okay, same thing for Lat wal-Uzza wa Manat. We know that these idols, they will not benefit us. It's not going to harm us. But we use them as intermediaries. We don't worship them. We just use them as an intermediary. So what's the problem? That's their shubha. That's their... Likewise today, the grave worshippers, they use the same shubha. Say, akhi, we know Allah is the one, al-Khaliq, al-Raziq. We know that. But Sheikh Abdul Qadir, he has a jah with Allah. He has a great position with Allah. Shafi'ah, intercessor. Yeah. Nah,
it makes sense now why the innovators,
you are right. They absolutely do that. Like these innovators, they love anything that is emotionally driven. Anything has to do with emotions. Like they may show pictures of Muslims dead in Palestine or other areas, and they play on the feelings of the people. You know, but they don't teach Tawheed. You are absolutely right. They never teach Tawheed. Never. And the only thing that's going to unite the Muslims is the Aqeedah. Nothing else will unite the Muslims. Because if we don't unite upon the correct belief, then we're going to have what? Different sects. Right or wrong? We're going to have different sects. And we have different sects, we're going to have what? Disunity. Are we going to have unity or disunity? Disunity. No.
Most of those people like the innovator.
Yes.
What they do actually, they try like to convince like the ignorant people. You know what I mean?
Yes, absolutely.
By fabricated like hadith.
Hadith.
And they come up with hadith. It's like there is none like
it. Like this hadith I mentioned today, I was shocked. Somebody sent me. They said, "Brother, is this authentic?" I said, this is fabricated hadith.
So this has to do also with knowledge.
Yes, and then now, actually, now, if you go to Medina now, is overpacked, overjammed with Sufis. Because they love this month. Why do they love this month? Because of this hadith. Because there's so many fabricated and weak hadith, you know. It shows you the evil effect of not having knowledge, you know. So now they believe that going in the month of Rajab, you know, to perform Umrah, this is the best Umrah ever. Because the reward is the best. And fasting the 27th day of Rajab equals fasting 60 Ramadan. Do you believe something like this? Ajeeb. Very ajeeb. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all al-ilm al-nafi' wal-amal salih. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Today we broke the record. We went over even the time of the questions and answers. Alhamdulillah.